become more self-aware, more at peace. It's got a number of health benefits. Now, time is short. I don't have a great deal of time to what we do, so I'm going to do as much as I can in a very short time. Gosh, you might have like intellectual curiosity, what mindful is, you might have exploration curiosity. I'm going to guide you through it. There are many health benefits to mindfulness. Obviously, I'm not a medical person. I deal with the mind. If one has a medical issue, they sure see a medical person from a biological point of view. But mindfulness has become more and more integrated in psychology these days. It's a much bigger part, just to keep the mind at peace. Does anyone have situations where their mind's racing away? So I think that's normal and natural, the way the brain's designed through evolutionary history. So the brain races and you think about all the things that are going on. And this sort of gives us a moment to be in the now. There's a power of being in the moment, and we're going to sort of experience that. In my experience years ago, when I used to work in education in the care sector, I used to be at a mindfulness, not as part of the reading, it wasn't my reading, but I'll integrate mindfulness into the sessions. And I worked with some very, very violent young people at the time in vegan and out security units. And when I first, this is a long time ago, when I was still fresh and new in many ways, people said, what's all that about? And I'd sort of get the young people to be at one, have some gentle music playing in the background, just to regulate the emotion, become more self-aware. At one time, I thought it was a really violent young offender, this young girl, a really, really violent offender, who really, really aggressive. And I introduced mindfulness to her, and at first she was like, what's all this about? Until eventually she sort of took to her, and she'd asked me to come in and help her along the way. And through being mindfulness, not putting it down to me, eventually she would sort of start to minimize her aggressive behavior. And I think it's a really important point, because at one point she struggled with mindfulness, and it's a really, really important thing these days. And I sort of thought, I wonder why she's struggling to be at one and be more calm. And I had a conversation with one time, and I think that part of her issue was the abandonment that she faced as a young person. She'd been moved from different homes and unstable with the background. So sometimes mindfulness is not good on people because there's nowhere to run, fight, flight, freeze. So the modern day was about mind, just be mindful. I think it's really important to know that for some people in certain situations, it may not be the appropriate thing. And you do more experiential exercise, which I'll leave with her until eventually it sort of integrates and fades. And the key thing is getting parts of the brain working again and helping people. Certainly, I think in the case of trauma, and trauma is not just, you know, fighting in a war, trauma can be domestic violence, can be abandonment. It has a big impact on the brain. And this day and age, people popping up everywhere. Just be mindful. And it's not always easy to sit there and be at peace. So I say that because we're going to have a go shortly. And I'm not implying that any of you got any sort of level of trauma. What I'm suggesting is sort of moving forward. That's really important to take that point. The other thing I'm going to say too, which is really important too, is that it can help a lot, especially if you've got exams coming up. Young people got exams, or they're finishing out the other things to see. It can be useful, not from the exam point of view, for the attainment point of view, but to be more focused in the now. Because you've got the pressure of, you know, 17-year-old being told at 17, you've got your whole life ahead of you. You've got to make a decision now that's going to be affected for the next 30, 40 years. And it's ridiculous, really. I'm not thinking about education, I'm being a teacher myself, that the neurons aren't forming in teenagers. They're told you've got to make a decision for the rest of your professional life. And that can be quite daunting. So for me, I think what's quite useful is to sort of bear that in mind and being what I want, being at peace, whatever decision you make is going to be okay. And being more centered, you'll have a better chance to get at the exam anyway. Because if you're ruminating, you're worried, what if I get to uni, what if it's too much, what if this? The land of what if, and the land of should, is not really a good place to be. Just be. The only moment you've got is now. Okay, the past is gone. The future future is not guaranteed to any of us. And I'm a big believer in setting goals, and also you set goals with your mind. Of course you can. The best chance to achieve a goal is meeting it now. And I've been fortunate about this stuff for many years, and I've written books and courses, and you can email me if you want the literature. I'm more than happy to send it to you. I'm passionate about this sort of stuff. I work with some top sports people around the world and business people. I do a lot of training, as you do. And what I want to do now is do a facilitation. So make yourself comfortable. You can, anywhere you want to go, you can lie down, you can sit down. I'm going to guide you through a mindfulness process. So I'll put a bit of music in the background. Exhale, at a ratio comfortable to you. mind and body are one system. Just like when you're nervous to do an exam, you may need to go for a wee, or if you get a bit flustered while driving the car, it's a bit hard when going out. So you can use your physiology now by reading into the abdomen. Your breathing feel calm, a nice sense of peace. In that nice place, I'm going to guide you through a facilitation. Perhaps you can imagine being at the beach on a nice warm summer's day, like today. And as you imagine being at the beach on a nice warm summer's day, or perhaps a swimming pool, I want you to imagine now walking towards the water. And as you walk towards the water, you dip your toes in. And as you dip your toes in, you feel a sense of coolness. And as you carry on walking into the water, the water comes up to your knees, and you can smell the sea air, you feel a gentle breeze, and you feel a sense of coolness up to the knees. And as you feel that sense of coolness, your body begins to sensitize the water's temperature. Feel a sense of warmth, radiating your shoulders and your knees. And as you do that, you carry on breathing and walking into the water. It goes up to your waist. And you feel comfortable, and there's almost a sense of chill in your thighs and back to your legs. And then you sensitize, feel warmth. The water, the wave, the gentle wave, flowing, has a massaging effect on your muscle. Just like putting your arm in the swimming pool and seeing your muscles soothe and like a massage. And as you go deeper into the water, up to your chest, you take a deep breath. Experience that coolness when you just go into cool, feeling cool, or in the heat, and then you desensitize. And whether you're in the pool, whether you're in the beach, whether you decide to swim or just walk, it's okay, I'm going to have a roll, you still have a sense of warmth, and calm, and tranquility, and that's the blue sky, and the water shines crystal blue water, a blue sky. You have to see a bright horizon, and that could be a plane flying overhead, leaving a trail. You see the trail, and you feel calm. There's nowhere to be, nothing to do, this is your time. And breathing actually normally. Really calm, peaceful. It's a great experience and a sense of peace. You have to hear God in the background, or you hear a plane overhead, and you hear that. You detach yourself from your thoughts, and just, you can be self-aware and see your thoughts like flowing down a river, and your thoughts are away. Flying down the river. And in an objectionable way, and you may have a mind, a work deadline, a dissertation, a building, or a plan, things you've got to do. And there's not a regular thing to do about now. And the only time you rise now, you can flow up. And you can be safe in the knowledge of what you've done in the past and what you're doing in the future as and when they arrive. Just being in the now, the gift of it. sunshine. And you can dry yourself a towel, and you can let the sunshine just dry it, you off, the tips of your toes, your calves, your quads, your tummy, your shoulders, back. Every cell in your body feels at peace. And you can let any negative forces in grab the atmosphere. Perhaps you decide to sit on the sun lounger or going about what you were doing before, or just going for a walk and feel a lot more centered and peaceful. Calm and focused. Well, enjoy the experience of the moment. As you do an experience and be at one, in your own time, your own place, you can come back to here and now. If you want to come back, you don't want to come back and stay with your partner. But you might need to come back because I believe we've got the class coming with each other. In your own time, in your own place, back to here and now. So there we go. The bottom of the music went off, but it's okay. One thing I didn't do, which I should have done, is I do like a heart rate test, and you time your heart rate at the beginning of the session, and you do it afterwards. It's obviously in my mind because I couldn't get the music going. And the benefit of doing that is to sort of show you how the heart rate can decrease. Now you can email me if you want to, I've sent you some audios I've got, and you can do it for yourself. Every time I do like mindfulness, when I go to a corporation, I teach MIP sometimes in organizations like the Air Force or top leadership or top. I always want heart rate to show people how heart rate comes down. And the significance of that is if you can take your heart rate from, say, 80 beats per minute, 60 beats per minute, it might not sound like a great deal for the beats per minute less than what it was before, but sometimes it goes as far as that. If that's a bit more, it's about 20,000 beats less stress from your heart a day. That's not including blood pressure regulation. That's not including many other benefits that can happen by being processed. And that's significant for me because one time someone said, okay, what's the big deal with heart rate going down? I said, you've got to make a decision when your heart rate is centered and then you hear the right thing in the room back again, make a decision. You're in a better place mentally when your mind and body connection is more centered. Okay, so that's one of the benefits of heart regulation. The argument will be, okay, your heart rate stay that way. Well, probably not, but do it again. Okay, I think in the society we live in, this will be a part of everyday life. This will be a part of like brushing your teeth, doing all the things that we do, in academia, and in exercise, because it's powerful, it's beneficial. I really believe it's going to get to that point, but there's so many benefits. Because of time, I haven't got a lot of time to go into all the benefits, but you can email me some information, literature, and you can do your own research. But it really is powerful stuff. And for the people who say, well, your heart rate stay that way, well, it may not go down. But one thing that will happen, it gives you a chance to grab it to center your mindset. But it may not go down, it may go down, it may not stay that way, but do it again. 10 minutes out of your day, now and again, to sort of recalibrate, I think, can be done. I think for most of us. Okay, if you've ever got 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day, then make an hour for yourself. Because it's really important that you take the time out. Because the analogy I use, you might not notice that if I sit this paper, if I do one rip, then you won't notice it. Probably not that much. But I keep ripping it. Apart from falling in the back there, he's going to tell the other man in the next. People end up in a mess. Now, this is mentally. It's not the one thing that happens to us, it's collectively. All these little things that build up. And like a can of fizzy pop, you shake it, bam. And I think that's really important because in this day and age, people don't know about mental health. If someone had a sprain in their ankle, they'd go to A&E. If someone had diabetes, they'd go get help. But even this day and age now, people got any issues with mental health, they still see a little bit of stability. And I think that we've got a great stigma. because just like our physical health can struggle sometimes, mentally it can too. People go through the bereavement, they go through the divorce, job loss, all these things can happen to people. It's not as easy to just keep going up and doing it. And I think that it's important to have a process to help us along the way. And that's no substitute for, obviously, professional help. It's complementary for me. It's not saying don't do that with this. I think it's about being holistic and uncovering every start we can to help people function at their best, at the optimum. That's one of the things I've sort of used as a model in professional sport and in business that we're totally involved in that area. So I'm mindful of time. Is there any questions anyone's got? Any questions coming up online before we get a chance to wander around the next class and there's so many great things happening today?
Stuff that you do, I think, is really good. I think can't be honest, it never happened years ago. But there is another theory, and I sometimes like that I perform better when I am a little bit on the edge.
Yeah, that's a really good point.
You know, if you said you spoke to sports people, and
yeah,
that's, you know, where does that fit in?
That's a phenomenal point. I'm just saying, I perform better when, if I'm doing a dissertation, if I'm doing a report, if I am, but there's a sort of fine line between sort of getting up there a bit motivated and let's bring it on to tipping over sort of edge and just, and it depends on your personality trait too, by the way. Some people, without going into too much detail at the time, if you get a chance to read the five factor personality model, and I sort of told you, some people are, they've got different personality types. Long story short. So some people might find that easier, but some people might not. So I think for me it's about what works for you as a person. If you find what you're doing is working well for you, then it's not broken, don't fix. That's not to say we can't always improve, but equally we've got a great point where some people will struggle to sit there and just be mindful. And it's about extending it from a minute to 2 minutes, 5 minutes, if you can. If some days you can't work for an hour, it's okay. Some days you might resist for 5 minutes. It's finding your own benchmark and being flexible, but also finding what works for you as a person too. And I think that it is important. I think that a degree of stress is useful, but bear in mind that the physiological effects of stress over time, the cortisol, that I had a conversation one time with a sports scientist that works at one of the biggest football clubs in the world. And he talked about how after Champions League fixtures, the players' cortisol levels are really, really high. And they tried different things like diet and nutrition and whatever, and it didn't really seem to reduce it too significantly. And one of my suggestions, whether I took my board or not, I don't know, was to sort of to do things like mindfulness, to deregulate. Because what happens is when you activate the so you've got the fight, flight, freeze response. Let's say you're riding down the road and someone cuts you up. You go into fight, flight, freeze mode. Cortisol gets flooded in the body. If you leave the tap on full blast, you might not notice it straight away, but in time, it's going to have an impact, an implication, I think anyway. So one of the theories I have is that, okay, to be self-aware, and someone yourself who is self-aware, who knows what their tipping point is, obviously, to some degree, emotional intelligence, self-awareness is important. But if you haven't got that, it would really make sense to do and be really self-aware at what is the tipping point. Because I know some people, the tipping point can be, if they're really under a lot of stress, they can break out in a rush. They can get a headache. They can get a number of colds and flus. That's not putting it down to the stress, but there's certainly a lot of cortisol in the bloodstream continuously. Won't be great. There's a sort of level. So it's not sort of the airy-fairy stuff, sort of, you know, nice bed of roses, be mindful and that sort of stuff. Yeah, we all agree with people, but I think it's getting that balance for me. And if something's working well for you, keep doing it. But if it is still working for you well, and you think I can sort of tweak things here and there, that's useful too. But I would personalize, I would individualize it, not a one size fits all. It's really important why you make there. And for some people, it's just, you know, I'm going to appreciate too, it's not for them. But in my experience, I've seen attainment, retention, human, and I don't want to take that out of them. I don't want them going to feel, you know, all peace and love and all. Oh, I want them to, you know, hit hard, just regulate, channel it. So don't go flying in and get sent off. Don't go in there and burn out. You know, just be sensitive, whatever works for you. And it's interesting point about it. Years ago, I was on the radio, there's a bit of a debate going on about, I mean, the World Cup's on now, we can sort of talk about that, about players singing the national anthem. And the fans, the radio, people listening in were saying the fans should sing, and saying they shouldn't sing. And I was like, whatever works for them. Because it's not a singing contest. Some people want to regulate the emotion. I mean, everyone likes their country, wants to do well, and they might think of players belting out the anthem. But for some people, the emotion that takes out of them when they go on the field, they just don't start from the up. But some people can regulate that. And the reason this is an example is that it sort of shows that we're all different, and our traits of personality are very influential in that respect. And that's not to say someone, you know, isn't as capable as somebody else, but it's finding their own benchmark, I think. Anything else? Any other questions?
Yeah, okay.
Does that sort of hit the mark?
Yeah,
I think for me, it's integration. You know, I've never really been a fan of people trying to, you know, ram it down and just